I'm super excited to teach people what we've learned about saving flower seed because there's no information on it. Like, this is the beginning. This is like the new frontier. It's going to be a blast. And then also what we're figuring out when it comes to breeding. I just think there's a whole new generation of plant breeders that don't even know they're plant breeders yet because they just don't know how to do it. But it's hard, but not that hard. And I'm excited to show people what we've learned.
Today, we have the pleasure of welcoming Aaron Benzocaine to the Growing for Market podcast. Now, for those of you in the flower world, Aaron probably needs no introduction as the force behind Florette Farm in Washington State, the Florette Online Workshop, the show Growing Florette on the Magnolia Network, and a lot of other great free educational materials that are on the Florette website, and three excellent books about flower growing. But what we're really here to talk about today is the recent release of the very first varieties from your own breeding program, the Florette Originals. So welcome to the Growing for Market podcast, Aaron.
Thank you for having me. This is awesome.
Yeah. I got to say, Aaron, I'm super excited to get to talk to you because I've been a fan of yours since I was working on farms, reading your column in Growing for Market magazine. But I realize probably most people got to know you and your farm through your social media presence. You were one of the early adopters of Instagram to connect with other growers, florists, and potential customers through the platform. I did not see that side of your work until much later, as I was a late adopter of social media. Now, before we get to the Florette Originals, I'd like to ask you about how you have used social media to connect with so many people. One of the main things I think our audience can learn from you is along the lines of what you wrote in the article, Become the Face of Your Farm, for the October 2017 Growing for Market magazine. I will make that article public and put the link in the show notes so people can read the whole thing. So I stay in touch with Lynn Bazinski, founder of Growing for Market magazine back in 1992 and author of the book, The Flower Farmer. It's because of her that we maintain the tradition of having dedicated flower content in every single magazine, along with the vegetables. And Lynn suggested this question. Did you set out to have the kind of business you have now? And was your early fame part of your business strategy, or did it all unfold organically with one door opening to the next? For example, in the early days of Instagram, did you think that Instagram would be a great way to market your business, or did it start out more as a way of connecting with people that ended up being successful marketing?
Oh, so many good questions. Okay, so I really got my start. I mean, this is such a full circle moment because Growing for Market was my first job that I ever got as a writer. Lynn gave me a shot and I wrote, you know, one article and I did okay. And what's so funny is I didn't even have Word on my computer. I would write my articles in an email and send them to her. And I deleted it happened where I lost some of my articles because I didn't know anything. But Lynn gave me a chance and being able to explore different topics and interests of mine and share them through Growing for Market was like a really big breakthrough. And at the same time, I was also trying to figure out like, okay, I'm figuring out how to grow flowers. I'm understanding how that's working. I'm sharing it through articles in Growing for Market. But the marketing side of things was so much more difficult. I mean, learning to grow is hard. Even if you have a natural gift for it or you really love it, marketing is terrifying. And figuring out how to sell your crops and your blooms and your, you know, the things that you've worked so hard to grow, it can be really, really difficult. So I started experimenting with social media mainly because I wanted to follow a few of the really incredible designers that were in New York at the time, and they were on this platform called Instagram. So I joined. And I had no intention of ever posting anything. I didn't think what I was doing was going to be interesting to anybody, but quickly realized like, oh, there is something here. And if I can get over my insecurity about being in front of the camera and kind of get past that, this could really be an amazing way to... It's almost like do your own marketing. I mean, now it's like commonplace, right? This is how we do it. You share about it on social media. But at the time when we were first, you know, getting going with it, it was very new and unusual and Chris and I just totally embraced it. We're like, you know what? Let's do it. Let's just go for it. So in the very beginning, it wasn't part of my plan, but I would say probably 3 or 4 months in, I'm like, we could do something with this. And then we went for it. So we put a ton of energy into it. We invest a lot of time, and I think it was really worth it.
Well, yeah, it looks like it. In the article, Become the Face of Your Farm, you said, once I figured out what my key crops were and how to grow them in my climate, the real work began. Mm-hmm. I had finally cracked the code on how to grow an unbelievable amount of flowers in a really small space, but what I didn't realize is that growing is only half the battle. Like many small farms, the first few years here at Florette were lean. During those early days, I did a lot of cold calling, knocking on doors, and desperately trying to sell the abundance pouring out of our garden. I'm not going to lie, it was a terrifying, miserable experience. For me, there's really nothing worse than approaching a complete stranger and trying to sell them something. So you say, on my blog and through my other writing, as I was sharing myself and connecting with others easily, but when it came to marketing, I was trying to sell and driving people away. So in the article, you talk about how you scraped together the money to pay for a session with a professional photographer to shoot your flowers, and you never had to cold call again. After that, you go into detail on 4 points: invest in good photography, share your story, don't be a shrinking violet, and use social media strategically. So that article was from 7 years ago, and you've done a lot of marketing and everything else since then. So you said, don't hide behind your barn, your flowers, or your logo. Your bio picture should not be a dahlia or tomato or whatever crop it is you specialize in. Customers want to see you and get to know you. Photos of inanimate objects don't connect the way quality profile photos will. So I wanted to talk about this article because I think it's easy for people to start following you and think that you're always successful and always good at connecting with people through your marketing. So I would like to ask you about how our audience can connect with their customers simply by getting out from behind the camera and showing their customers who they are. Do you have any advice for people on how to connect with their customers, especially if they are shy or otherwise not used to being in front of the camera?
Totally. So what a lot of people seem to be like, they don't believe me when I say I'm incredibly introverted. I'm very shy. I don't like groups. I've never done a farmer's market because I can't bear the thought of standing with all of my hard work and hoping somebody buys it. Like, I could never do it. I never want to walk up to somebody and just introduce myself. I mean, I'm not good at it. And I was terrible at selling. I was so bad at it that people were like kind of backing away from me, like physically, like moving backwards. So like I understand what it's like to feel very kind of uncomfortable in your own skin, and it can be painful. And I found that through using a camera or a, you know, you're basically your phone nowadays because they're so good, is so much easier than trying to establish those connections in like on a one-on-one, at least for someone like me. Now, if you are very extroverted and you are smooth and you love people and you love crowds, man, get out there and sell it. Like you don't even need social media. But if you're a weirdo introvert, like many farmers are, we want to hide in the fields. We want to work with our plants. We generally are not like, you know, it's, so I find that social media is a really great tool, but so many of us, it feels weird to be the subject. It feels weird to be in front of the camera, especially if you, I don't know, it can just make you feel like really cringy and embarrassed, and you know, you feel really stupid. And I have for years, I felt that way. But over time, with more practice, got more and more comfortable and found that it was worth the squirminess, because then at least I didn't have to walk into a florist shop and try to sell our lilies, you know, like I could just do it by making, you know, taking some really beautiful photos or making a short video explaining why they're great. And so my advice to anybody who's feeling really insecure about it or uncomfortable is, obviously you don't want to do anything where you're pushing yourself past a level of comfort where it's like violating to your own privacy, or you don't have to post any pictures or videos of your children, or like, don't make yourself do something that's like an awful experience. But if you're just a little bit nervous, or you just need a little bit of a nudge, I would say it's very much worth it. And people want to buy and support other people. Like, you can buy radishes from 30 different vendors at the farmer's market. Why do I want to buy radishes from you? Because I connect with you, because I love how much you love your radishes, because I watched you direct seeding them in the field. Like, you took me along for the journey and the story. And so I think building that connection between the customer or the consumer and the farmer is such a powerful bond that we can make. And we don't always have to do it one-on-one. We can use the tools that are now available if we want them. But I've seen many, many, many thousands of farmers adopt a more front-facing approach when it comes to marketing and telling their story, and had so much success. So it really does work. And it's very much worth the discomfort if you can kind of just make yourself do it.
Well, that's a good point. And it just made me think about how there are so many beautiful moments in farming, you know, whether it be like the last armload of flowers you're bringing in as the sun goes down, or like just a beautifully harvested, you know, crate of like cucumbers or whatever you're harvesting on the day, and how those are really pretty private moments that have a lot of beauty unless you take a picture. And so I think that should be motivation right there to just realize that if you're in this business, you're probably doing something beautiful, whether you're working with flowers or vegetables or whatever your crop is.
Absolutely. And we think that we're so used to this, like this is our daily life. This is our view. This is what we see. And we're like, oh, you know, the flowers are pretty, but I just harvested like 3 truckloads. But for someone who doesn't live on a farm or get to grow things for a living, and often it's their dream, especially if they're buying directly from farmers, that there's a little bit of a dream in there that they have of their own. Those moments are so magical and so powerful and will really pull people in if you can just take the 5 minutes to stop and compose a, you know, a photo, or take a minute, get a little video, and then share it. People are so hungry for a connection with nature and a connection with you.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, our day-to-day is filled with interesting moments, and so few people are farming anymore. You know, almost nobody gets to see that side of it. And so that's a really good reason for people to just get over it and put some stuff out there. One of the things that I've noticed in my short time doing this is that it can be paralyzing to try to make content, because we get hung up on being perfect. Mm-hmm. And that's hard to do. Or I know some people are worried about getting criticized by, you know, like somebody they don't even know, you know, on social media. Do you think it's good advice to not worry too much about being perfect and just start putting content out there that reflects what we are doing, whether we think it's perfect or not? I figure there's a reason everyone who's in this business is in it. And if they can show that to their customers will relate. Because one thing I've noticed is that once you get started putting some content out there, you can see what works, see what your customers enjoy, and be guided by that. And it will feel less like shooting in the dark.
Totally. And I think when you, even the word content, right, feels overwhelming. You're like, oh man, when I think if I have to make content, I'm like, man, I just gave myself another job. Like, that sounds dreadful. Like, what am I going to do today? What's my content? So I never even think of it like that. My goal is to find one beautiful thing, one interesting thing, one notable thing. Just find something today to share tomorrow. That's it. Take it one day at a time. Sometimes you have something kind of pre-made or set aside, but I just really work to find one thing that's worth sharing today and then posting it tomorrow. Like, keep it simple. It could be the beautiful radishes you're bringing in from the field. It could be your direct seeding, your first zinnia crop, and you're so excited about them. It could be that you had a terrible storm that blew away your greenhouse. I mean, it's just find one thing. It could be big. It could be small. It could be beautiful. It could be ugly. It could be just getting into the regular habit of posting, and definitely don't make it perfect. Oh my gosh. Like calling it content, thinking of it like content, thinking of it like being perfect, all those things are just going to get you all bound up and stressed out. Don't overthink it. Just find one thing It could be a video. It could be a photo. Like you could start, it doesn't, you don't have to be in it. It could just be a picture of what you see, your point of view. And then maybe in a few months you get a little bit more comfortable. Maybe you start to be in some of the photos, but just, it's more important that you post regularly, that you share it regularly than it is about even what you share. I think it's just start to build the muscle, get comfortable, get into the routine of it, and then it'll stop feeling like a job and more of a way to express yourself.
Well, that's a really good point. And I think that should be a really great entry point for people because, yeah, most of us who are farming have, if not a moment of beauty every day, at least see something interesting, you know, something that another grower could learn from, an interesting critter, you know, that comes into your day or something. So that seems like a really great entry point of just be like, most days we have at least one interesting moment. And it that may also help the days not just like blend together, right? Because in the busyness of the season, whole seasons, you know, whole springtime can kind of fly by just because it's so busy. And so that might also be a great way to sort of like slow down and remember our lives is to be like, you know, I might only remember this moment from this day because it was such a busy day, but it was a beautiful or worthwhile or memorable moment. So,
yeah. And then you have that like almost like catalog of your life in images. Like it's a gift to you. Yes, you're looking for something. I mean, for me, I find because there's so much difficulty and stress and hardship that having to force myself to look for something beautiful and meaningful is a really good act because it helps me. I'm a glass half empty person. So I'm always looking for that glass half full. And so it's a helpful exercise for me. But I also have this beautiful like thread of images of my, you know, the last 15 years of my life because I've been documenting it. And it's just a ritual. It's a habit and it's beneficial both for your business, but it is very much something you can look back on and be like, oh yeah, that's what's happening that day. I found that big fat toad in the hole. And it was like the first sign of spring. Like, yeah, I remember that day. You're marking those moments, the big ones and the small ones.
Yeah. Well, that's really good advice. I appreciate that, Erin, because I'm trying to learn from this too. Like, you know, really, I'm always thankful to Lynn Bozinski for thinking of me when it was time for her to pass the magazine on to somebody else. But yeah, I'm an introverted, nerdy writer, you know, left to my own devices. I would sit in my office. If I'm not, you know, growing something, I would sit in my office and just write stuff all day long. So, I mean, honestly, part of this podcast is part of trying to be more proactive, and I'm so glad that I started it. Well, because I wouldn't be sitting here talking to you if we hadn't, but also I've enjoyed it more actually than I anticipated as an introvert, because it's really just an excuse to think of the most interesting people in our field and call them up and go talk to them.
And ask them questions that you've always wanted to know. Like when I got to interview people for Growing for Market, I'm like, basically this is an excuse to just ask them a bunch of personal questions that I'm curious about. It's super fun. Like it's awesome. It's also challenging, right? Though I think it's really great to pick one thing per season to challenge yourself with. So like a podcast, like that's so daunting. I can't even imagine like what a commitment that is and how it would be so difficult and also so growth inducing. You can do the same with like social media or marketing, or, you know, you pick one thing and you're just going to invest yourself in it and kind of push through that discomfort, because there is so much value to be had on the other side if you can just sort of get over yourself a little bit.
Yes. Yeah, that's so true. That is very meaningful to me because now we're a little more than a year into our podcast, right? And so I feel like we've gotten past the initial stages. And I heard this thing the other day. It was, if you're succeeding at everything, you're not trying enough stuff. You know, like basically.
Exactly.
And because I think as humans, we hate to fail. It doesn't feel good, but it has actually inspired me a little bit to maybe try some projects through Growing for Market or through the farm that are, you know, maybe I'm not 100% sure if they're going to take off, but it's like, well, they're not going to sink the business if they don't, and they could be a really nice addition. So that's, I think I appreciate that advice, Erin, and I will definitely be taking it to heart, and I think it'll be useful for our audience as well.
Awesome.
But So I appreciate that, though. You know, what we're really here to talk about is the Floret Originals, of which there's been a ton of interest, I know, because I told our audience that we'd be talking and ask for their questions. And over half of the questions were about the Floret Originals. So they just launched recently, but I know they've been a long time in the making. How long have you been working on the varieties that just got released?
The first variety that I ever started working on was Golden Hour. It's this beautiful kind of, you know, honey-colored zinnia. And that was 7 years ago. And some of the other varieties, I would say between 5 and 7 years that each of the varieties that we've put out into the world has been in development. So it is a very long road to bring a new variety to market, having it in a stable, you know, getting it stabilized so that when people grow it, it comes back true to what they expect. Oh man, and I am very impatient. I don't like things to take a long time. So this has been brutal, but also very good for me.
Yeah, I can imagine. I mean, breeding is playing the long game, definitely. Okay, and so you say you've been working on Golden Hour for 7 years, and I know a lot of people say it takes 7 to 10 years to stabilize an open pollinated variety. Is that because you saw the zinnia that looks like Golden Hour today, and you were like, I want that, and it's taking you that long to stabilize it?
So I found one plant in a field full of zinnias that was an off type. It was in the incorrect variety. And I saved the seed from just a handful of flowers off of that plant, grew those seeds the next year. And, you know, 3 out of 100 of them came back looking like the one that I wanted. So I ripped everything else out, kept the 3, covered them over, let the bees, or, you know, now it's flies, but let the bees do their work, saved that seed. Then a little bit more of it came back true, a little bit more. I've found with zinnias, it takes about 5 years to get a variety really stable, where you just have a few off types, where you don't have a hot pink one or a bright yellow one throw out every couple hundred. But for the most part, you're like, yep, that looks right. And then typically the next couple of years are just building up stock. Because once a variety is stable, then you put it into production. And that's where you have to then bulk up to get enough seed. So, you know, for me, it's been about 5 years to get a variety where I want it. And then another few to get enough seed to share. Some things go faster, some things go slower, but you just never really know.
Right. I think that's part of the process that a lot of people who are buying seeds don't think of. It's not just getting the variety the way that you want it to be. It's having enough that you don't, you know, like sell out on the first day, which also must be kind of a guessing game for you. Because I know you've sold seeds from other people for years, but you must have just had to, I don't even know how you came up with your projections for how much seed to have to do this launch.
It was a guessing game, really. I mean, our highest selling varieties ever. And then you're like, do we times that by 3 and then multiply it over multiple years? Like, I don't know. So it was definitely, it felt weird. That was the most unsettling part of all of this. We want to have enough seed so that if we're really going to share about this, and people have been following this journey for so long, they really want them. But what does really wanting them mean? Like, how many packets worth do we need to produce? And the worst thing, which we've done in years past, you know, when we used to sell dahlias, it's like, do not release something that you don't have enough of, because it's super disappointing. People are so invested. They're so excited. And then you sell out within an hour or minutes. And while it can be kind of exciting, it really burns the customer. Yeah. Like, the person has invested all this time with you and then they have this terrible experience. So our launch day was very stressful for everyone, because we were all like, is it going to be enough? I think we were all asking that question, and we had enough. We had enough, and we still have seed. So it is amazing. Like, everybody who wanted seed got it. And that was my goal, that we would have enough available. So very exciting. But oh my gosh, trying to figure out those numbers was super nerve-wracking. And I'm really glad that we were on that side of it and not, we didn't underproduce, because that would have been horrible.
Yeah. Well, now you have some hard numbers to go with for future productions.
Totally.
Can you tell me, are there traits that you're looking for across all the Floret Originals, and or specific variety traits that you could tell us about?
Yeah. So, well, I've worked on 3 main flower groups over the last X amount of years. I have other things that I would love to have in the future, like yarrow or poor man's orchid, or there's different things, but those are coming someday. But my big focus has been zinnias because they thrive in pretty much every climate, super easy to grow. And they're just like that perfect market flower. They're just such a great local crop, and they can't be shipped because those necks break. So they're really awesome for local farmers to grow. But all the colors on the market, besides the Queen series and a few of the Benneries, are bright. You know, you've got that magenta and scarlet and gold, and you know, it's just like, there's plenty of those colors. So really what I set out to do was see if I couldn't develop flowers that had that great, beautiful fullness and size and long stem length, like a traditional zinnia for cut flowers, but with softer colors that went more with the trends that are popular for weddings and event work, because that's really where the money is in flowers. If you're selling to florists, they need flowers for weddings, but they don't typically need bright red zinnias or bright pink zinnias. They need blush and champagne. And so that's the work with zinnias, is those softer colors with those great same qualities. And then for celosia, same long stems, very abundant production, but could we get a wider range of colors? Because so often with celosia, there are some nice colors that are on the market, and the Bombay series is amazing, but a lot of the plume types, they're kind of more bedding plants. They're shorter. So I wanted to get that, the traits that we want: long, strong stems, very productive, and unusual colors. Because again, I think those would really have a market with florists and just set a farmer up for success. And then the dahlias are just fun. I've been breeding dahlias for years now. I love it. Growing dahlias from seed is this crazy, like, wait, what? I didn't know you could grow dahlias from seed. And so we worked on four different mixes that are each unique. And the babies that come out of that mix are kind of a range of forms. And so they're obviously they're not perfect, but they're like all pretty much anemones. They're all pretty much collarettes. So those are the three groups that we've put out recently.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm glad you're doing that, because as people may or may not know, so much of the breeding that's done is by big multinational companies, which I don't mean anything bad by that, but they're also not very targeted. They're trying to serve the largest customer, and they may not even know what the trend is. You know, it might not be on point. And so I do think that the colors that you've released are going to be really popular.
Yeah. And in my experience, the very large companies, the main bulk of their flower seed or flower plant business is bedding plants or selling to the box stores. So Home Depot and Lowe's. And so it's that kind of lowest common denominator. What's the most, you know, most volume, brightest colors, very showy. And that's not what a small farmer needs, especially to compete with all of the imported blooms. And so, yeah, just really, we've been focusing on how can we have fun with this breeding project, but how can we solve the problems that we see in our own market and arm these small growers with something really unique and really special and really beautiful that can command a very high price, and they have to be bought locally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great mission. I know you said that at least at first, you're focusing on the flowers that don't ship well, in order to give local growers an advantage, thus the zinnias, celosia, and dahlias. Are you working on other crops that we should be looking forward to being released in the future? Someone asked specifically about hollyhocks, and I know you've done work with sweet peas and other crops over the years. So do we have other species of Florida originals to look forward to?
Oh, I mean, we have a lot of dahlias. So separately from the dahlia seeds, I have, oh man, hundreds of dahlia varieties that I've bred and am working on that are in that development stage. They're going through getting put through the paces. So I'm working on a whole range of dahlias that have those great soft colors, long stems, and that are kind of like more targeted for weddings and market, you know, weddings and floral designers. So I don't know how those are going to make it into the world, because I do not want to have a tuber business, but I'm working on developing the varieties. And then sweet peas, I have no intention of breeding sweet pea varieties, but I have every intention of helping save the sweet peas. So we're going to be working on more sweet peas, seed saving resources. I have two chest freezers full of seed. I have close to 300 varieties that we're preserving here. So I want to be the hub for the sweet pea information. I want to save the sweet peas because they're very endangered. I want to empower people to start a sweet pea business, you guys. If you are a grower in a climate that grows sweet peas well, there is such a massive global market for sweet pea seeds, especially if you can get comfortable with marketing. If it's ripe for the picking, so somebody or five people, reach out, because I will tell you, it is totally worth it. Like, someone needs to pick up the torch with sweet peas. So I've got the seed, we have the information, and I want to help, but no sweet pea breeding happening here.
So does that mean you're going to stick to zinnias, celosia, and dahlias?
I have other things in the works, but it's hard to say, like, will it work? Like yarrow, I'm trying to tease the individual colors out of different mixes. Could I just have a raspberry, just have a blush, just have a champagne? Could we get buttercream? I don't know yet. So if it works, then there would be a whole, individual color range of yarrows that you could grow from seed. But I don't know that I'll be successful yet. So no promises. But these are the three groups I'm really focused on at the moment.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
Well, I see from the notes on each individual variety that there's a little variation left in most of these, which I think is great when given a choice between having Floret originals now versus waiting another few years until they're completely uniform. I would take now. Plus, most of them are mixes anyway, so it's expected that there's going to be a range of colors. Are you going to continue selecting these varieties and the mixes until they're more uniform, or release individual varieties that you stabilize from these mixes?
So we're continuing our work on these main first varieties with the intention of, in the beginning, we could not figure out how do you select for a more double flower, say with the like Golden Hour or Alpenglow or Precious Metals. Getting the flowers that nice full form is a bit of a challenge. And so we're going to be continuing to refine the colors, but really focusing on those big full double flowers. So the mixes will continue to be refined, though they're pretty there. I mean, you shouldn't see anything crazy coming out of Precious Metals or Golden Hour or Alpenglow. Where you'll see the few off types are in the Dawn Creeks. Any of those, I cannot get rid of this bright yellow that keeps jumping out. So maybe every 100 plants, you might get this bright canary yellow. I'm sorry. I just don't know how to get that to not happen yet. So, cause we're learning. But the bulk of the flowers that come out of a packet, I mean, a vast majority will be true to what you see in the picture. So working on refining those mixes and then teasing out the individual colors. So Precious Metals has five colors in it, and I've separated the five colors and am working on all of those. So there's like an icy lavender, a linen, the kind of Golden Hour buff color, so, and a pink. So I'm separating them all out. Same with the unicorns. There's right now it's this beautiful rainbow mix, but I also have like 11 different individual colors that I'm working on. So it's just becoming more complicated. Like, I'm just coming up with more varieties. I have 130 zinnia varieties I'm working on currently. And everybody keeps saying, like, you gotta like limit it, but I can't, because they just keep having babies. Like, it just keeps multiplying. Like, I'm not in charge here. I'm just along for this ride.
Yeah. Well, that's why most people aren't plant breeders, because it tends to multiply. Yeah. You know, I've known so many growers who have either found a sport or a mutation, or, you know, one plant that looks different from the rest that they're saving back. But to really embrace a number of breeding projects at one time, yeah, it's a huge job.
It's a huge, we have over 400, not quite 500. So somewhere in that range, unique varieties that we're working on here on the farm between the celosia, dahlias, and zinnias. So the organization behind that is insane, but also super fun. And I don't know, I love a complex project. It's fun. And we don't come to this from, I mean, Eric, who's here on the farm, who is like really heads up the seed saving portion of our work. He has more of a background in science. Like, he went to school for some of this, but I don't. I'm just intuitively doing this, and they just keep multiplying.
Yeah. Well, in yeah. with that many varieties, it's also just keeping track of everything. I know there's, you know, like people think about it's fun to come up with new colors and things like that. But then you must have lots of spreadsheets, you know, just like keeping track of everything, you know, whether you have fresh seed of it and the parent lines and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, it's quite a project.
Yeah.
I see that you stopped selling seed produced by others and are only selling Floret originals now. Why that change?
Well, as we've been getting closer to being able to release the Floret originals, trying to balance both projects, because the breeding has just exploded. I mean, it's been a big project and it's been running parallel to everything else that we're doing, but it is my true passion and it is very complicated and it needs all of our focus. And then there's the seed company that we've had, you know, for all of these years. It's amazing business. So many wonderful, beautiful flowers, so many varieties. But when we started it, it was based on a need. The varieties that we offered were not available to the public. You could only grow most of them if you were a professional grower. You had to get them through a wholesale catalog. So the intention behind our original seed offering was to make these amazing varieties available to home gardeners or smaller scale flower farmers. But now the game has changed, which is awesome. Like every major seed catalog has a whole section devoted to flowers and cut flowers specifically. And there are tons of small flower seed businesses starting up. So I feel like my work here is done. There is a wonderful market for it. And there are many great suppliers and options now. So I can step off of that path and really focus on the need I see and the problem I see that needs to be solved now, which is we need more varieties that are suitable to local production and that meet the demands and the needs of their client base. So that's where I want to put my energy. So really the intention behind, like it's bittersweet because it's such a wonderful thing. And I love all of the varieties we've offered and many of them we grew here on our farm, but in order to really hunker down and get into the breeding, I had to choose. And so breeding won.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
I think that's a good choice. And it's a really good point that you make that people might not realize if they got in more recently that the information about flower growing was harder to come by, you know, 10 or 20 years ago. The varieties were harder to come by. And I think that Lynn Bazinski and you and the Arnoskis, and there are a few people who just shared information, got the information out there. You know, you helped bring some of those, make some of those varieties available to smaller growers in a way that it may not be apparent now. So that does make a sense why you're focusing on your own varieties, since that's obviously quite a project in itself.
Yeah. And I love working on a project that is a solution to a problem. So even figuring out how to market flowers, I knew I was having that problem, but I knew if I could figure it out, it would help thousands of other flower farmers. Same with the seeds. The mission behind it is to solve a problem. So now we're just, once the problem's solved, I don't need to do it anymore. You know, like it's great, done. And now I want to move on to the next thing that needs our help. Yeah.
Yes. All right. Well, yeah, thanks for that. Because I know we're seeing so much interest in flower growing right now. I mean, at the magazine, mm-hmm. we measure it because we're getting subscriptions from more and more people all the time with, you know, like Flower Farm in the name.
Yeah.
And it just seems like people are really interested in flower growing right now. Maybe the way that people were with vegetables 10 or 15 years ago with the local, you know, locavore movement. It seems like whatever is going on, it seems like flowers is having a moment now, but it's only because, you know, there's been a lot of work done by you and a lot of other people like laying the groundwork. It seems like it's really taking off now, which is so great because, as you know, so many of the flowers used in this country are imported and flown in. I think that it can seem daunting. I think it's something like 80%. You might know better than I, but it's a really big number of the flowers that are used in this country are imported, and that can seem daunting. On the other hand, I think of that as that's market share that local growers can take if they can
absolutely
just, you know, figure out what to grow, how to market it, make the connections, and those kinds of things. And so that's of course what we're trying to to help happen here at Growing for Market.
That's so awesome. Yeah, you're so right. Like all that 80% is all up for grabs. And we, if we can just share our story and grow beautiful things, then we could take the market. So let's do it. Like, let's go.
Yeah. Yeah, let's do it. Well, you filmed a seed saving mini course for these varieties, and we got a lot of questions about seed saving. So it certainly doesn't seem like you're discouraging people from saving seeds from Floret Originals. So what are the rules around people saving them?
So when it comes to the Floret Original varieties, we're asking that people do not save the seed with the intention of selling it, but saving the seed for their own personal use, to share with friends, to trade, and to use in their own breeding work, go for it. I'm going to show you how to do it. We're just asking that the seed that is on the market for sale is coming from our farm. And then in the future that we have established relationships with seed growers that we have approved based on their experience and the quality of their work, and that we've arranged, you know, set up special arrangements with. So I'm super excited to teach people what we've learned about saving flower seed, because there's no information on it. Like, this is the beginning. This is like the new frontier. It's going to be a blast. And then also what we're figuring out when it comes to breeding. I just think there's a whole new generation of plant breeders that don't even know they're plant breeders yet because they just don't know how to do it. But it's hard, but not that hard. And I'm excited to show people what we've learned.
That makes a lot of sense to me, especially coming from a background in the seed industry. You know, people who have listened to this may know I used to work at Johnny Selected Seeds. And, you know, I think part of it is that you as the breeder have the vision. You know, you have the vision that created that crop. If I can just share a quick anecdote. So, you know, I worked in trialing. And so some of those old open pollinated varieties were available from a few different sources, you know, particularly varieties, you know, there are some varieties that have been around for decades, right? And so they're available from multiple sources. And it was part of my job to try the open pollinated varieties that were available from multiple sources and see what the good source was, right? Because as you know, as a breeder, some companies did a really good job of, say, roguing off types, right? That's something people may not think about, but you know, in open pollinated varieties, there's always plants that either just aren't as good as others, that don't conform, you know, conform to the colors or the shapes or the types that we want. And, or, you know, cross pollination can happen, you know, if they don't get their isolation distances right or whatever. And so what we noticed is that some companies do a good job of that, and some companies do a bad job of it, because it's work. It means somebody has to go out to that field and A, know what the crop is supposed to look like in the first place, and then be diligent about roguing out any off types, you know, if it's an open pollinated variety. And, you know, it was obvious that some companies cut corners. And so even though you might be able to source, you know, there are some very popular open pollinated varieties you might be able to get from four or five different seed suppliers, or we called them multipliers, you know, because they were not doing the breeding work. They were just bumping up, you know, old open pollinated varieties. And so I had notes on which company, you know, of those four or five companies had the good version, and which companies not to buy from because they weren't doing that. And so I'm sure as the breeder, you don't want to see, you know, versions of your work that have not been maintained very well come on the market. So
that's such a great point, because if you do not consistently rogue and refine a variety every single year when you're producing seed, it will go to crap. Like, if so fast, like you have to really, really work at it. And when you're growing out seed for a seed crop, you need to use stock seed that is of the highest quality, which is not often the seed that is on the market. Like, this is a separate set of seeds that is the extra doubles. It's the very most refined. It's the freshest. It's like all the things that you need to start with. And then you need to know, what are you looking for in off types? Roguing religiously, You know, just there's so many things that you need to keep in mind. So producing really high quality seed that is true to type and all of those things, it is an art form. It's not, you know, anyone can save seed, but on a professional level with, you know, high germination rates and, you know, very low percentage of off types, it's a tremendous amount of work. And so if just everybody's doing it, the reputation of a variety can go bad very quick if it's not done right. So the seed saving that we're going to be sharing about is more on that kind of backyard scale, home gardener level. But in the future, we're working on, I'm calling it a manual because it's more than a book. I'm looking at it over on the shelf. It's like three spiral binders, seed saving. I don't know if it's a course, it's definitely a manual, but it will be much more of that technical farm scale. But in the beginning, I just want to show people how to start with the basics and just, you know, start saving some seed and having fun with it.
Well, that's great because, of course, that happens a lot, I think, is that growers are growing a variety and, you know, one is not like the others. And it's not even clear, you know, it could be a mutation, could be, you know, a seed from another variety accidentally made it in the packet. And that's the most interesting one. Like, I think a lot of times we don't know why these varieties, which might otherwise be called an off type, you know, if you have, a row of 100 peach zinnias and one is, you know, some other color, but it could be a really intriguing color. You know, that's where some of these new varieties come from. But I think it's really appealing to try and preserve the new varieties that we see, but it is also a lot of work. And I mean, you're giving credit for some of the work yourself. I know from reading on your website that some of the zinnias you are releasing were developed from a collaboration with Corey Hargreaves of Dawn Creek Farm, which people can read about on your website. So I think it sounds like you're paying it forward or whatever you want to call it. Like, you're definitely giving credit where it's due, it sounds like.
Yeah, and it's not just even credit. So to begin with, Corey is an amazing flower breeder in California. Very small scale. She's like this magical fairy of a person. And the varieties that she's been developing are magical fairy flowers. Like, there's no other way to, like, when you grow them, you're like, these are from the fairies. They're so special and wonderful. And she sent me some seeds years back. I started growing them out and saw a ton of potential in them and had a conversation with her because she didn't have the land to be able to scale up these varieties, to be able to someday offer them as, you know, in enough volume to meet the demand. But we had many conversations to begin with, and I got permission from her to grow her varieties out with the intention of selling them. So I think that's the first thing to keep in mind is that you need to get permission. You can't just take somebody's work, put it into production and sell it without, that's where the problem begins. So we started with building a really great relationship out of respect, asking for permission. And once permission was granted, we created a royalty structure so that in the future, when the seeds were available to the public, a percentage of the earnings from those seeds go directly back to the breeder. But that was all negotiated between us, and those percentages were based on what is fair and right and what she wanted. I'm not just going to take somebody's thing and go do what I want with it, which I see done very often, especially with her varieties. And so we're trying to figure this out as we go, because there is no model that we've found, especially in the flower world, but then also be very open and transparent about that relationship so that other people can see. Like, if you want new varieties to come onto the market that aren't from those big, huge, giant companies, which probably aren't going to be focusing on things that the small grower wants, because we're not a big enough market. If you want independent plant breeders to be working on things for you, you have to give them credit, ask permission, and compensate them. So that's really what we're working on solving. And it's been a really, really fun challenge. Both of us have been really passionate about it. And it's so exciting to see four of Corey's mixes go out into the world from our farm, and knowing that that's going to then support her breeding work so she can continue to do what she's so good at. And then we can take on that kind of harder part, which is not harder, but, you know, it's a challenging part of the production and distribution.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's why I think that's one of the reasons why there are so few independent breeders of vegetables or flowers, because it's a long time to pay off. And it's a very complicated process. And then, you know, especially if you're breeding open pollinators, they do tend to get ripped off or pretty quickly.
Yeah. And you see it in the dahlia world as well. Many of the dahlia breeders they're retired, usually, like the ones who are very prolific, and they've bred so many amazing varieties. But does any part of the, so someone buys the tuber, clones it, you know, through divisions or cuttings, sells it, no money goes back to the breeder who came up with that amazing variety that's changing our lives. Like, how is that? That's not good. Like, how could anybody ever do that as a business? And so that's been part of what we've been trying to figure out. Like, how could this be a viable career option where you don't have to go work for one of the big four companies? You know, like how could you do this and actually not only make a living, but just like have a really sustainable business and I don't know, help the world, right? Like independent plant breeders can solve a lot of problems, but they have to be able to make a living doing it. And so, yeah, that's part of what we're trying to help figure out.
Yeah, that's a really good point. If people want there to be more independent breeders in the world, they need to make sure that those breeders are getting their royalties or their due, however it is. So, you know, it's like anything else. If you want more independent breeders, support them.
Absolutely. So. Yep, exactly.
Well, on that tip, do you know when your seed saving mini course is going to be released?
We'll probably let people start signing up for it once summer begins, but you can't really save the seeds until probably August in most climates. So I'm thinking it'll probably be August, but we'll be able to sign up once summer starts. And the mini course is going to do a deep dive into celosia, zinnias, and dahlias. So it's going to be a lot of fun. I'm excited. We filmed it last summer and we're like, oh man, this is just going to blow people's minds. Like, this is going to be so fun. It's going to be really cool.
Yeah. Okay. So focusing on the three crops that you just released.
On the three crops. So if you got seeds from us, we're going to show you how to save them. And then the course will be free. So anybody can take it and you can save any zinnias, any celosia, any dahlias. It doesn't need to be ours, but we'll show you how to do it.
Yeah. Well, and that's one thing I was reminded of while I was kind of doing my homework for this this interview. I went to your website. There's so much on your website that's just free. Your website is such a great resource. People can get a lot out of it without even paying anything. I think that's one really great thing you've done, just putting so much information there that anybody can access.
Yeah, my hope is that we give away more than we ever sell. Like that we share as much as we possibly can. And then there's a few things that, you know, just because we have to stay in business and have a business that we do sell, but the rest of it is free. And that's always my favorite part. If I could give it all away, I would.
Yeah. Well, fair enough. I think you're doing a great job of that.
Thank you.
So a lot of growers asked about isolating flowers so they don't cross-pollinate. And I'm thinking that's not really possible on most farms where you have a lot of varieties packed close together. Cross-pollination is what's going to happen unless you do hand pollinations and bag them or something like that, which is part of the value of breeders and people doing the saving that seed, right? Is that they've gone to the lengths to either build isolation cages or whatever. But I mean, am I right about that? It's like the thing is, if people do plant your varieties or any for that matter, they're in a field with a lot of other varieties, they're just going to tend to cross-pollinate, right?
That's true. So you need to, in order to be safe, you need about a quarter mile between zinnia varieties to ensure that they don't cross. And if you have a flower farm or even a veggie farm that grows flowers, you cannot, most farms don't have very many isolations, maybe two, maybe three, if you're lucky. So because I wanted to grow more varieties than we could isolate outdoors, that's where we started getting into converting many of our hoop houses into isolation cages. You know, like trying to figure out like, how could you grow multiple varieties and have, you know, save the seed and have it come back true. So yeah, if you're growing outdoors and you have five varieties of zinnias, you can save the seed from them, but it will come back as a mix because the bees are doing their job and they're crossing all those varieties together. Yeah. So for zinnias, it's about a quarter mile. Celosia could be a tick less, but we still don't have like exact feet on it. But I would say, again, to be safe, a quarter of a mile. And then dahlias, they never come back true anyway. You can have them come back true to form-ish, but dahlias are just so wild and crazy. They don't come back true from seed. So yeah, it's distance or some type of structure. Like you have to keep the pollinators that you want in and the pollinators you don't want out.
Right. And even that quarter mile is a minimum distance, right? It's like, it's really even better. Like if you really want to be serious about it, it's better to be even more, like particularly if you're trying to sell seeds to somebody and need them to come true. I know, because in my former life in the seed industry, so I would sometimes have to go with our seed production manager. And if, like, say we had a cucumber seed production, we would go talk to the people who lived close to that field and ask them if they had gardens and ask them not to grow cucumbers. Yeah, we would be like, we will bring you cucumbers if you just don't do it. Because, you know, think about, what's doing the pollination for a lot of these things is insects. They fly, they get around, you know. So if you want, if you really want to know, like it really is, you got to take it seriously. And, ideally go above and beyond that, those isolation distances, if you really want your varieties to come true.
And especially like say zinnias, if your neighbors are growing them, but you're only growing one variety for a seed crop, but your next door neighbor has zinnias in their, you know, flower beds, it's not going to work.
Yeah. It's just the birds and the bees.
Yep, exactly.
The flowers and the bees, you know, they're going to, the same bees that like their zinnias probably like your zinnias. So
exactly.
Okay. So when you said that you adapted your hoop houses to breeding greenhouses, this kind of dovetails into another question that I had. So everybody wants to know about the flies. So
I will tell you about the flies.
So is it that did you put nets on the houses to keep insects out, and then you put flies in them? Tell us about the flies. How does this work?
Okay. So you cannot use honeybees inside of a structure to pollinate your seed crops, because honeybees can't be kept in any kind of captivity. Uh-huh. So if you have a larger space, you can use bumblebees, but you need to use like I would say at least 20 feet wide by 100 feet long is probably like the smallest space you should put a hive of bumblebees in to pollinate. But if you're doing any breeding work or you have smaller amounts of flowers, you don't have that much space. And so the next best alternative is flies, and they're blue bottle flies. We buy flies in bulk as larvae that comes shipped to you. It's like basically these, so disgusting. Just get ready. It's so disgusting because they're grown on fish waste. They smell like when you go to the dump on a hot day. And it's like the mist, it's just like rotten everything. You get this box, you have to open it. They come in a basically like a sandbag, sort of like a tarp-like bag. You fold it open and you scoop the larva out, and you have to dose your houses, and then they hatch. But yeah, so we buy larva on a weekly basis from this awesome supplier in Idaho called Forked Tree Ranch, and you order blue bottle fly larva. I think it's like $13 a cup or something. And we buy a lot of larvae, and we use those for pollinators. So they're actually very good in a small space. Like if you're doing a tiny little isolation, or even if you were wanting to put them inside of small bags, you could put a few larvae, put one of those jewelry bags around a flower and close it up. When they hatch, they'll do the work, but they're incredible pollinators. They last for about 10 days. Then you need to restock the supply. And then we just keep redosing all these small structures with larvae. And then they hatch, they do their work, and they die. And it just keeps going and going. You can grow your own larvae if you would like to. There are plans online for how to do it with using like a Rubbermaid container and rotten fish. But I feel like it's not worth the savings. Like just buy them. It's so much less disgusting. We've grown them on wet dog food. That's even worse. So I'd say just buy them.
Yeah. I think that's, I mean, I think a lot of farmers try to be really independent and do everything themselves, but I think it's also good advice to not try and do everything yourself.
Yeah. I mean, you certainly can if you have a passion for it, but it's pretty handy when the box shows up. But yeah, so we use a lot of flies for pollination, and we have taken our hoop houses and taken the end walls off and put insect netting so that you've got good airflow, but you're keeping the outside pollinators out. And then inside we either have bumblebee hives or we have flies. And then we have smaller structures that say are over like two plants. And we call those flycellations. And they're using the Johnny's hoop bender. And then we extend the pipes up, you know, give them little extra legs, cover it in bee netting and release flies inside.
Beautiful and gross at the same time.
Yeah, you can do it too.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, I feel like that was an important thing for me. When we started farming, I was like, I'm going to do my own plumbing and my own electrical work and everything and save my own seeds. And then, you know, it was after trying to do all those things that I realized like, oh, there's actually, you know, a very specific way that you have to do seed saving for it to be come true. And that's a whole nother drag on the business. And don't get me started on electrical work. You know, I still have all my fingers. So like I learned quickly enough that it's good to farm some things out. You know, there's reasons why there's exactly. seed companies out there, you know, keeping track of the parent lines, doing the isolations and all that kind of stuff. So you don't have to, you know, as the right. grower. So,
yes.
I think that was an important.
And there's someone in Idaho who raises fly larvae. So yeah. you don't have to, I mean, there's a business for everything.
Yeah. Support your local fly industry.
Exactly. So,
a few people ask what your team is like. And I'm certainly curious, given how many irons you have in the fire. And you actually, I looked around on your website. You have you list a lot of your team on there. But just to honor our audience's question, can you tell us a little bit about your team and how you keep all those plates spinning?
It's a lot of plates, definitely. So we have an amazing group of people that we get to work with. And it's kind of divided. We have what we call the creative team. It's basically me, Jill, Chris, Laura, a couple other people that we make the things, right? So if we're doing a book or a guide or a mini course or the newsletters or any of the photography or just basically anything that's going to become something, that is what we work on. Any kind of outside communication. So we have a small group of us that work on those things. And then we have our shop team, the gals who pack the seed, who work in the shop, who ship orders. And then they also work out on the farm during the summer months. And then we have the guys who work on the farm that do, like, that's where they are full-time year-round. During like big shipping pushes, they'll come in and help in the barn. So we kind of have like three main groups and we all cross over and work together at different times. Chris and I are part of every team, but we have, yeah. So it's like farm, shop, and then creative, which is just everything that we ever make or share or write or film, that all comes out of there.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So the shop and farm team are on site here. So they come to work every day on the farm, which is also where we live. And then the folks that we work with on the more creative projects, they are mostly remote. Mm.
Okay. Well, that makes sense. Yeah.
I don't know if that's like a good enough explanation, but it's definitely grown. I mean, in the early years, it was me and then Chris worked full time. He helped after work and on the weekends and then our kids. And now we have, you know, whole staff of people, but that was like a slow transition. It took many years to get there. And it comes with its own set of challenges and also like a ton of benefits. It's mm-hmm. just, yeah.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that because yeah, you have an admirable number of projects going on and that's a nut that I'm trying to crack personally because I can think of way more things that I'd like to do than I have time to do personally. And I just always try to learn from people who are doing it. In fact, a few weeks ago, I was listening to an interview with Jam Fortier on the Bootstrap Farmer podcast. I've become a big podcast listener. And they asked him how, you know, like how he kept all these different projects going. And, you know, he said that he makes himself the fifth wheel on every project. It's like, that he can work on it, but that it doesn't come to a screeching halt if he's not involved. Like it's like the executive, I think he said this, that it's like the executive chef in a restaurant. You know, it's like the kitchen can go on if the executive chef isn't there. And so I appreciate that insight, Aaron, because there's a bunch of projects that I would love to do with Growing for Market if I could just figure out how to do them.
And I would say for myself, I'm a bit more of a control freak than the executive chef. Like I'm the chef. Like, I don't know if I'm the first wheel in every project. Like, some things, like, I make the plan. I decide what I want to do, how I want to do it, and then I get help laying out the project itself and then get support in the doing of the work. But I'm very hands-on in deciding what it's going to be, how it's going to be done, where it's going, who it's for. Like, I'm not often that people say, like, just hire somebody to do it. That's just not our style. Chris and I are very involved in pretty much everything, but it's definitely in the laying out and designing. And we just keep a lot of, like, our hands are in it, which is probably what makes it, like, all feel like so much. But I think that in my experience, when I've let off on being so involved and, like, really being connected to the work, then it just doesn't have that same charge to it or essence. But I guess for us, we have gotten help in the areas where we drop the ball. So if we're really good at something, even though somebody else should technically do it, like, you shouldn't have to do that. I hear that all the time, but I'm actually good at it, or I like doing it. And so I keep doing it. But what I'm bad at is, like, keeping my schedule good. I'm terrible at technology. I even hate to type. Like, Jill and I, when we're writing, I walk the room and talk and have my eyes closed and talk it out. And she's typing. Like, I get help in all the areas where I have blocks.
Yeah.
But then in the areas where I am passionate about it or just good at it, I keep those. And so I think it's finding support in the places that you just struggle, or you're just never getting any better at it. That's the first place I would focus on getting help. Mm-hmm. So that you can bring your dreams to life. Like, you could still, you can add more irons to the fire.
Yeah.
If you can get help on the stuff that you're not good at.
Yeah. Well, that's actually really good advice right there. It's like, know what you're good at, know what you're not good at, and get help for the things that we're not good at.
Yes.
That's probably great advice right there. So try to take that to heart myself. Well, before we sign off, I wanted to ask what the future holds non-breeding wise. Will there be another season of Growing Florette, or are you working on any other books or anything?
We are. So currently this season, we've spent 2 years so far working on a seed saving. It's going to be some kind of book. I don't know if it's a manual or a book, like what it's going to be. And I think my hope is that this season we can finish it. So we're 2/3 of the way through this big seed saving book project. And then we have also been in the early stages of starting, I don't even know how to describe it, like, not a production company, but doing our own filming. So the folks that we worked with on Growing Florette, the director, Rob Finch, and Sarah, one of the editors, and then Jamie, one of the cinematographers, we have all started working together on our own separate projects. So you've seen, we've done a couple of documentary films, and we've started to do more filming, and so there's a lot of that, I hope, in the future. So that's kind of our next big thing that we're pouring a lot of energy into. We just want to be able to tell the stories we want to tell, explore the ideas we want to explore, and do those through film.
Well, cool. I can't wait to see what comes of all of that.
Yeah.
Well, I really appreciate you taking the time to sit down with us today, but I always want to make sure and ask, is there anything I should have asked you about or anything else you'd like to say before we sign off?
You asked great questions. You asked so many wonderful things. I think my last thing would just be that Growing for Market is such a fantastic resource. Getting to write for it changed my life. It helped me get my start. And also reading all of the articles written by people that are really in the field, doing the work, sharing their wisdom and their advice and their, you know, their wins and their losses. I mean, it's just such an incredible resource. It's like by the people, for the people. I can't recommend it enough to enough people. But yeah, the work that you guys are doing is incredible. And it's changing so many people's lives. So I'm like very honored to get to be here today and talk to you and to your listeners and just, what an awesome community.
Yeah, well, good. Appreciate the kind words. Yeah, I do. You know, it's interesting to think about what place a magazine occupies in the current world where there's, you know, there's social media and online courses and so many things. And I like to think we can kind of occupy that space of just coming out 10 times a year, really hearing from other farmers. And I like to think there's a there for us.
There absolutely is.
Yeah, it helped us a lot. You know, we read it when we were learning how to farm, and we hope to keep it going for that. So, well, I figure most of our audience probably already knows how to get a hold of you, but where do you want people to look you up, or where can people learn more about all your projects?
Our website is probably the best place to go. It's like the hub for all things. So that's floretteflowers.com. And then if you're on Instagram, I'm Florette Flower. We have a YouTube channel. We're on Facebook, you know, kind of all the places. But yeah, you can go to our site and there's tons of growing information, resources. You could sign up for our winter mini course, which is about seed starting. You could sign up for our seed saving mini course, which will be coming in the summer. But and then our newsletter is actually where anything that is happening or coming up that's like exciting and you should know about, we talk about it through our newsletter. So I would sign up for that. It's not annoying or lame or anything. It's actually interesting and helpful, and it kind of keeps you in the loop on everything that's going on.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Lots of great free resources on your website. I get your newsletter, which I enjoy. Yeah. Seeing what you're up to. So, oh, lastly, I just want to thank you for sending me some seeds of the Florette Originals. It's still really cold here in Maine. We've got snow on the ground, so I haven't started anything yet, but I'm having to stop myself. I'm itching to get them in the ground. And so, I can't wait to see how they grow here in Maine, and I'll, you know, post some pictures on Instagram or on the Growing for Market. So thank you so much for that. And thanks for taking the time to sit down today and tell us about them. I've really enjoyed the conversation, Erin.
Yeah, I so appreciate you having me.
All right. Well, thanks. Take care. We'll talk to you later.
Bye.